Okay, so welcome everyone to Green County Leaders January 2021 session on leadership, community nonprofits, and community involvement. Welcome to those of you who are Green County Leader alumni and to those of you who are joining for a taste of Green County Leaders. To everyone who is joining us now for the session and for everyone tuning in later for the recording of this session, we are just so glad you are here. I'm going to introduce myself. I'm Victoria Solomon. I'm the Community Development Educator with Extension Green County, and Kara Carper, Executive Director with Green County Development Corporation. I also want to give special recognition to the Green County Leaders Board members. I know we have a number joining on the session today, which is fantastic. I'm going to do a really quick intro to Zoom if you are not familiar with that. So if you're on a computer, along the lower bar, there is an icon on the lower left side that's a mute, unmute on the lower left side of your screen. If you're calling in via phone, star 6 will mute and unmute you. There's also an icon on sharing your video. It's on the left side of your screen. If it is possible, please turn your video on. Trust me when I say we will not judge backgrounds. Kids and pets are more than welcome to join, and you are more than welcome to have lunch during this session. That is fantastic. So in the chat, let's quick and do some introductions so that we can kind of get to know each other a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and put mine in. Like I said, I'm Victoria Solomon with the Division of Extension. I work in Monroe. I live outside of Monticello. I'm on the Southwest CAP board, and I'm co-owner of Perfection Produce. So please go ahead and put introductions in the chat. So I know we have some new folks joining. Special welcome to you. We are so glad you are here. I want to share a quick intro to Green County Leaders. The purpose of the program is to help build leadership skills, deepen understanding of community issues here in Green County communities, and provide opportunity to create, expand community networks. This program is possible through a partnership with the UW-Madison Division of Extension Green County and Green County Development Corporation, with strong support from lots of businesses and organizations across Green County. So today, we are focusing on leadership, community nonprofits, and community involvement. We're going to kick things off with a powerful session on holistic leadership, and then we're going to check in on things happening in Green County. First, we'll have an overarching update from Teresa Keene and Kara Carper. So we'll hear about key things happening in both the nonprofit and business sectors. We are fortunate in Green County to have many great nonprofits. And part of today's session, we'll focus on a panel to really hear about some specific updates from some nonprofits. And these are entities you may know about and you may not. Finally, we will close with an opportunity for small group discussions to share big takeaways from today and good news sharing. Our first piece today is on holistic leadership, and Lori Rodefeld is going to sort of bring us back to, I'll be real, one of my personal favorites of Green County Leaders, the Wheel of Life activity. And this is something that I have found simple, but really a powerful tool in reflections and intentionally moving forward in growth. It can be particularly useful, I've found, in January. So if you're a Green County Leaders alumni, you may remember some of this. It's always a good reminder, and I feel a very active tool. If you're new to Green County Leaders and just getting a taste, hold on to your hats, because this is going to be fantastic. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Lori Rodefeld, Medical Education Manager and Coach with Monroe Clinic and Green County Leaders Board Chair, for a session on holistic leadership. Lori?
Well, thank you, Victoria. I'm going to share my screen. I have a very simple PowerPoint. It's obviously very shortened from what we normally do cover when we are in our normal class session. Usually I think I have an hour to an hour and a half to talk about wellness. We used to call it life balance, and I really don't like that term because I think it makes you feel inadequate when you are trying to balance it all, because it's almost impossible. I feel like, you know, if one area is great, the other area might be suffering, and there's so many different aspects to your wheel, and we'll talk about what the wheel in tells in just a little bit. As Victoria said, I am involved with the Green County Leaders Board. I'm involved with the curriculum committee. I love to have the opportunity to present with Green County Leaders any chance I get. One of my passions is education. And I kind of got roped into the wellness side of things almost by accident as we were talking about wellness and our curriculum. You know, I said, how about we talk more than just about, you know, how you're doing physically. It's wellness is so much more than that. And that's one of the reasons why I really like the Wheel of Life, because it really allows you to kind of take a snapshot of where you're at with a variety of different things. And you'll see there's a sample wheel here. I would encourage you, if you've never done the Wheel of Life, or even if you have done the Wheel of Life, take some time and do it today. Do it tomorrow, and just kind of get a sense of where you're at. I think that it's such a great tool to just kind of do that check-in with yourself. And the great thing about the Wheel of Life is it's a snapshot. It's a snapshot of today, how you're feeling, how you're doing. You can do this, you know, once a month, once every 6 months, once a year. I encourage you to use it as just a way to check in with yourself, especially if you're feeling a little off balance. And there's different aspects of the wheel. The sample wheel has some things, but the things that are typically included include relationships, kind of your social interactions or social opportunities, maybe financial wellness. How are you doing financially, professional or business? You know, how are things going in that realm of your life? And then business, what's interesting is there actually is like a business wheel of life. So if you're interested in kind of taking a deeper dive into your business and looking at like, how are you performing? That's kind of a fun tool as well. And then there's personal growth. And that's, you know, really focused on like personal development. And I think, you know, I know personally, you know, it's been harder this past year, you know, to do those professional development opportunities, just as, you know, travel budgets are cut, conferences, you know, maybe aren't happening that were happening in the past. You know, so again, those personal growth opportunities definitely look different. And then there's spirituality. So that was mentioned earlier in social, but you know, if it is something important to you, you can have its own little slice of the pie. So kind of how the Wheel of Life works is you've got this big pie, and then for each area, you assess how you're doing. So you shouldn't have a perfect circle. Every area should look different. And hopefully, you know, your wheel isn't totally full, because I mean, you know, then you're just a rock star and you're doing awesome. But really, you know, you should see different areas get filled in different ways. So here's an example of how that might look. This is just an example Wheel of Life showing, you know, in this particular scenario, the person's doing great with health and spirituality, career's not as great, finances aren't as great. And then after you do this assessment, you kind of, you know, set some goals based on that. And I think that that's one of the reasons why we like to do this session in January, is typically we're doing some New Year's resolutions. We're looking at, you know, what are my goals for the year? What do I want to do? But I think unfortunately with COVID and just the way 2020 rolled out for so many of us and just all of the uncertainty, it's tough. It's tough to set goals. It's tough to have New Year's resolutions or commitments when there's just so much uncertainty. So we really wanted to just spend some time talking about that. So I kind of just did a little bit of thought around, you know, how COVID has impacted well-being for people. And obviously there's many other things that, you know, that are impacts, but these are just some examples. You know, so for, you know, your relationship or social side of the wheel, you know, we're all social distancing. We're trying to stay 6 feet apart. You know, I'm working at Monroe Clinic, but, you know, it's just different because I've got to, you know, keep my distance, wear my mask. You know, most meetings have moved online or via Zoom. You know, it's just hard to have those face-to-face interactions. They just feel different. You can't read people's body language. You can't see that they're smiling and they agree with you in a meeting. It's all very, very different. You know, and then I think just on a personal note, you know, I know, especially in the wintertime, I'm seeing my friends and family a lot less. You know, it was easier in the summer. We could have socially distanced bonfires and, you know, at least have that interaction. But it is a struggle now. We're not seeing people in the same way that we've seen them in the past or as often. And I know for many of us, the holidays, we didn't have a chance to see our friends or family. Normally, you know, our Christmas, we dropped off presents outside at my parents' house and, you know, gave them a virtual air hug. And that was my Christmas with my family. I'm so excited for things to get better. But, you know, again, there is an impact to how you're feeling in that Wheel of Life. For physical wellness, obviously there's a lot of impacts. You know, it's colder, you might be spending more time indoors. You might not want to go to the gym. You might not be able to go to your yoga class anymore. You might not be, you know, getting together for like group runs, depending on, you know, how you're feeling about social distancing. You know, then you just might have new stressors or tension. Maybe your kids are online for school. You're trying to help them with homework. You're trying to work from home. There's just so many things that are different with regard to like our physical wellness. And then I don't know about you, but when I'm home and I'm working from home, it's a lot easier to snack or eat more frequently. So that can even play into your physical wellness as well. For professional and business, there might be more uncertainty, you know, just regarding your short-term future, or even your long-term future. Things are changing at a rapid pace. You know, I know, you know, we don't even know what next month looks like, let alone next year. And again, that, you know, can make it hard to plan. It can make you really even just feel like things are out of your control. Spirituality is obviously different for a lot of people. Maybe harder to connect face-to-face with people. You may be attending church online. You may not be able to volunteer, and you'd previously volunteered before. You may just not be able to connect with your community in the same way. So again, there's a huge impact also to, you know, spirituality. And I'd also like to say that that's community as well. And then there's financial wellness. You may be just worried about your employment. You may be worried about upcoming bills. You may, you know, just worry about how your friends or family are impacted. So we're all seeing different ways that COVID has impacted us, you know, with regard to just different aspects of our wheel. And I think that, you know, doing this exercise really just helps you kind of get a better sense of how you're feeling, but I think more importantly, looking at what opportunity you might have. So again, I kind of just laid out a bunch of, you know, kind of things that I think have been rough for all of us. And I think that it's important to acknowledge that, but I also want us to think about how do we move forward and, you know, how have we moved forward? I think, you know, for example, you know, my birthday was New Year's Eve, and normally, you know, I'll get together with some friends. We don't go out and stay up late, but we'll go to dinner. And it was hard doing a Zoom social hour with my friends. It was a lot shorter, and you know, it was nice to see people, but it was definitely different. But I will say, it was so nice to see faces that I haven't seen in a few months. So again, that was an opportunity. You know, what I've learned from that is I need to find more of those opportunities to connect with people. So what I would like to do is, Victoria has agreed to break you out into groups and to allow you to have some discussion around the Wheel of Life. And you may have done the Wheel of Life before, you may not have done the Wheel of Life before, but I just kind of gave you some ideas of areas where you might be struggling in the past, maybe you're struggling now, and how you'd like to make an improvement. So again, just to remind you, the areas are relationships, social, financial, professional or business, personal growth, spirituality, and you may have other things, you know, well, just, you know, physical wellness. Just think about, you know, something that's on your mind that you'd like to share with the group. And the group might even be able to help you come up with ideas about how you can move forward in 2021. Because again, you know, if we just kind of accept the status quo, we're not going to improve our wellness and we're not going to improve our well-being. And we really want to just take that opportunity to take a snapshot of how we're doing, how we're feeling, and where we can grow. So Victoria, can we move everyone into their groups? And we're going to probably give you guys about 5 to 10 minutes to discuss. Victoria and I will kind of see where how we're doing for time. Well, I think we can do 10 minutes. We'll do 10 minutes for everybody to discuss, and then we're going to have you break out and kind of just give some ideas that you shared. It doesn't need to be a comprehensive list of everything, but if there was something, you know, that kind of stood out, please share that after you break into your group. So I'm going to let Victoria do that now.
Sounds good. I will pause the recording.
Great. Hold on. I have to get back to this slide. Everyone can see it. So this is, you know, just kind of reminding you what we were talking about, areas where you struggled. And then, you know, as a group, we were talking about, you know, ideas for improvement. I know our group had some good discussion. Al was jokingly saying he was going to open a bar, but no, he really had other ideas. He just missed the social interaction. But I'm wondering, does anybody have anything that they'd like to share that came out of their group? Some good ideas, some strategies people have implemented?
Okay, I'll go on the physical side of the wheel. I did say that I felt like I was really suffering nutrition wise because all of these meetings used to include dinner. and there's nothing being served. Green County Healthy Community Coalition was always a great meal catered by self. You know what? Nobody serves me dinner anymore. So I'm just pining away here.
That's a great one, Rick. I love that. But you know, you can, you know, learn to cook. That could be a goal for 2021, right? Do some cooking or get some takeout. We have great local restaurants. There's, you know, all kinds of ways to explore. Do anybody else have anything?
Well, I'll go. Our group mostly just talked about just the social challenges. And I think we were just sort of sharing, you know, really, we didn't go, we discussed a few minor things, but everyone talking about different, you know, just sort of finding your center again. And that was, I think, you know, hop in and let me know, Chris, Matt, everybody, you know, Jody, let me know if I've got that correct or not.
Well, you're spot on. And as we talked about the circle, the wedge that we all kind of focused in on was social and just how much more challenging that is. But also I think the challenging that with all the pressures that are going on right now and all the divides, it's just very difficult even to connect with people that you've known for years. With certain topics, you don't know if they're going to reach out to you or lash out to you know, at you. And it's just a very unsettling time. But
yeah.
Becky, what did you share? Something one of her friends said, this is December 37th. You know, we don't want to admit yet that it's 2021 because it feels like
a few days ago, she was like, this is the worst December 37th ever. You know, it was like, she just refused to say she was moving on.
But I think that, you know, what you guys were talking about is just, I think it's so important, you know, just with regard to the wheel of life and with regard to how you're feeling, I think acknowledging how you're feeling is kind of that first step in like making things better. And you might not have a solution. You might not have like the perfect answer, but I think just acknowledging that something doesn't feel right and that something might, you know, need to maybe adjust, or you might even need to adjust your mindset, is so important. I think that, you know, it's just good to be reflective, and it's good to think about, you know, how we're feeling, why we're feeling that way. And then, you know, ultimately trying to move forward with hopefully better days ahead in 2021 and not December 37th or whatever we're on now, December 41st. I don't know. I'll just keep going. Any other thoughts?
Well, I will also add our group kind of ties duality and that social piece together, because, you know, like all the facets of life, you can't, you'd like to think you can separate them, but you can't.
It's all interconnected. The wheel, it kind of, you know, divides it into a sliver, but really it's connected 100%, 100%. Well, gosh, thank you everyone for being a part of this discussion. It was, you know, fun to put this together, fun to just look at, you know, how we're doing, you know, how, you know, the COVID era absolutely impacts our wheel of life. And, you know, I just challenge you all to just take some time and actually like print off a wheel or go online and fill out a wheel and just see where you're at, where you're feeling. I know we kind of did some reflection on one particular area, but I do think that there's a lot of value in taking that holistic view of how you're doing right now and then looking ahead to 2021 and finding those opportunities and those ways to hopefully, you know, make an improvement. I'm optimistic with 2021, with vaccines rolling out and, you know, just better weather ahead. I think, you know, we'll hopefully be in a different place by, you know, 2022 will be, you know, not even talking about this. So with all of that, thank you. It was fun connecting with my group and connecting with all of you. I'm actually going to pass it along to Kara and Teresa, and they're going to be talking about an update, as Victoria mentioned. So I will let them get started.
Thank you, Lori. That was amazing. It's always great to do the Wheel of Life, and that activity is probably more relevant now than it's ever been. So thank you. That's great. And it's always good to have those discussions. I enjoyed talking with my group as well. So I think Kara and I are going to talk a little bit about some of the things happening in the community. And so I will, Kara, if it's okay, I'll start with some of the things United Way is doing, and then we'll kind of end with this, the thing I'm probably the most excited about. So we'll talk about, but I just wanted to say, you know, just like everybody, United Way has been adapting and changing and trying to really meet the needs of the communities. And so I know I've talked a lot before about a lot of the ways that we've helped provide relief to many, many organizations in the community. But I also wanted to talk about, as we're continuing to provide relief, we're also really assessing community needs and working collaboratively with multiple partners to try to figure out where we go next and how do we rebuild, but how do we reimagine what we want Greene County to look like, and so that we can be better and stronger than before. You know, let's always look for things that we can be positive about and proactive about and excited about. And so one of the things that I wanted to share, and I accidentally put a link in the chat, but I will send it all together. There's a number of links, but the first is working with, in collaboration with Greene County Public Health and with the Community Health Fund with Rebecca Thompson. We've established what we're calling a Greene County Helpline. And the number is 608-325-1596. And that's a number where people can call and leave messages specifically if they've been impacted by COVID. So that is all of the contact tracing that's happening in the county. People who are positive get sent letters. And in that letter now, there's this community hotline is included. So people can call it and leave a message. And we have trained community volunteers who are willing to check those messages and call people back. But really it's, you know, we just found our public health is working incredibly hard constantly, and they are, you know, overwhelmed. And so we said anything we can do to help. And so they simply don't have the capacity to follow up with people like they would like to. And so, you know, if someone tests positive and there's questions that they have, maybe they need help getting groceries. Maybe they need help signing up for unemployment. Maybe they need help getting utility assistance, they would call this number and we would call them back and get them the resources that they need. And just to be a follow-up resource to people, maybe they're just scared and unsure of what's happening. And so that's been established and I'm really excited about that. In addition, this afternoon, I'm gonna be a part of a panel that's talking about, I just recently learned that Wisconsin's going to receive $380 million in rental assistance, which has been a big conversation that we've been talking about, is there's been moratoriums on rent. But at some point that's going to end. So how are we going to get assistance and how are we going to help people so that we can avoid a crisis? And so I'm excited to hear and learn more about that today, but that'll happen actually today at 4. So lots of really exciting things happening. And then one of the other big things that we've noticed through COVID is that our childcare system has been, is simply inadequate to meet our needs. We know that only in our county overall, there's only one childcare spot for every 3 kids who might need it. And so, and in some areas it's even significantly, the ratio is significantly higher. And we knew prior to COVID that this was a problem, but it really, really highlighted, COVID-19 really highlighted the significant need for adequate, high quality, accessible, affordable childcare in our area. And then given the fact that many kids weren't in school or they're in school part-time, we had some amazing community organizations who stepped up to really provide some additional services and support for agencies. But that's where I'm super excited to work with Kara. So United Way and Greene County Development Corporation have partnered to try to really put together a comprehensive plan to help meet a lot of the needs of childcare in our area. So I'll let Kara talk and we'll kind of talk together.
Thanks, Teresa. You know, United Way's motto is better together. And through this crisis, I've found that in our county, especially, that we're all better together. And I'm just so appreciative, especially to all the businesses that stepped up. I sit on the Emergency Operations Center committee, and we've had a lot of businesses that have stepped up with personal protective equipment, with signage, with basically if anything is needed, businesses have stepped up. And so we're really delighted. I always say that Greene County is a special place, and that if you ask for something, you're likely to get it. And in other places, that may not be the case. So we're really thankful to our businesses and to individuals who have stepped up during this crisis. I see that Tana from Emergency Management is on the call. We have crises in Greene County every year, whether they be snow blizzards or flooding. But we really want to be able to count on our businesses and on people to support us during crisis. And we've seen that during COVID. So a big shout out to our businesses. As Teresa mentioned, we are really focused on the childcare industry and the fact that we need additional good quality childcare in Greene County. So we got some grant funding to put on boot camp classes. So if you know of anyone who is interested in starting a childcare business, we want to get them started and going in their childcare business. So we've got a childcare business boot camp. It will be starting in March. So it's an 8-week class, one night a week. And when you graduate from that class, then we've also got a safety Saturday class so that you can get your CPR, all those sorts of things out of the way. So basically, when you get done with boot camp class, you could potentially start a childcare. You still need to take classes to get your licensing, but we can start you at a small scale, sustainable business. We really want to grow some sustainable, strong childcare providers in Greene County. So we're looking for anybody who is currently running a childcare business, whether you're licensed or unlicensed. We'd like to provide these classes to you. The classes are free. They're going to be virtual. And again, we want to make your business as strong as we possibly can. We really want to make Greene County the place where we can tell all of our employers that as you are recruiting people to come here, that we've got the highest quality childcare available anywhere in the Midwest. That's really a goal. We need really good quality childcare. It's so important for child development. We know so much more about brain development, and those first years are so important. So we really are trying to put resources to ensure that we have adequate and good quality childcare here in Greene County. So if you know anybody who's interested in starting a childcare business, anybody who's already running a childcare business, but maybe would want to boost their business, maybe there's some things, not every business owner is good at everything. And in fact, there's no business owner that's good at everything. So you might be great at caring for kids, but your financials may suffer. So how can we help those businesses be as strong as they can be, making sure that they're profitable, making sure that they're getting paid on time? And also Teresa's working on tuition assistance for those families that they didn't budget. They didn't plan for their kids to be home when they're attending school virtually. So we're trying to help families as well as childcare providers to be as profitable and as successful as possible. And again, for anybody who would like to work in the childcare industry, we have lots of slots available right now. So if you wanted to work in childcare, and also that Safety Saturday class will make it possible for you to be able to work in the childcare industry. So again, both of those classes are free. The other thing that we've been doing is we've been holding a toy drive at, I'm looking at the window, at Toy House and at Kinderladen in New Glarus. So Toy House in Monroe and Kinderladen in New Glarus both have lists of from daycare providers in Greene County of toys that they need. So during COVID, they have to wash their toys in between every child that plays with them. And that's really hard. You think about how hard that is on plastic, how hard that is on wood, how hard that is on puzzles when they have to be cleaned over and over and over again every day. So we've got a toy drive going on Kinderladen and Toy House. So just stop in and they'll give you the list and John at Kinderladen and Stacy at Toy House will take you around the store and show you all the wonderful things that they have there. The last thing I wanted to talk about is business support. We've got a number of chamber folks on the line today who can also talk about this, but January, February, March are never good months for retail, and they are especially bad during COVID. So think about how you can continue to support local businesses. They need your support, and they'd appreciate your support. So if there's something that you normally buy in the summertime, or if there's something that you wouldn't normally buy, please stop by and think about what local businesses can do for you. If you're not comfortable going into the business, give them a call, check out their websites, because they are happy to do drive-by delivery. And so we have many options for ensuring that we are keeping our local businesses as strong as possible. Teresa, anything else I forgot?
I mean, you hit it. I think I'm super excited. And if you haven't worked with Kara, you need to, because she is incredible. And as I'm learning these, this childcare thing is a monster. There are so many facets to making sure we have, you know, people with good business models, people with, that we have enough spots, but also that we're providing high quality services that are affordable and accessible to everybody and not in our community, not certain populations, but all of our populations, because we know that our economy and overall our society and our communities are better when that happens. So she is amazing, and I'm honored and excited to work with her on this. And I feel like we're making some great progress. And so it's really, really exciting. And like she mentioned, I guess Greene County is amazing. When there's a need, it is, I mean, always people step up and we get things done. It's absolutely heartwarming and incredible. So it's really, really exciting. And I think with that, we get to introduce Chris, who's going to kind of facilitate our next panel. So Chris Wellington is a phenomenal community member and DCL board member, and just all around fabulous person and great person to know. So I'm excited she's facilitating this next panel, and I think we'll get a lot of good information from these nonprofit agencies as well. So I will turn it over to Chris.
Thank you, Teresa and Kara, both for the updates. Our next section, we have about a half an hour, and we have four people with us today who are going to tell us a little bit about the organizations that they lead and what may be happening in them, and a little bit about how you might be able to get involved with those organizations should you have time and an interest. And the four people that we have today are Rick Leeson from Family Promise and Marcia Voss from Greene County Greene Cares Pantry, Jeannie Bloomer from Southwest CAP, and Deb Douglas from the Fowler Dental Clinic. And our first speaker is going to be Rick Leeson. He's the Executive Director of Family Promise. Why don't you tell us just a little bit, Rick, about what Family Promise does and who you serve and what your mission is? Can't hear you. You are, yeah.
That's how you keep me quiet. So Family Promise is part of a national network. We are one of over 200 affiliates across the nation that provide services for families in homelessness, helping families at risk of homelessness. And the unique piece is that each of the affiliates, wherever they're located, for example, us here in Greene County, are able to create our program around the specific needs of the families that we serve here in Greene County. And as that changes, like it has during COVID, we also can adjust and change our programs on a moment's notice and be able to structure them in a way that we can help those individuals with the needs that they have. It has been a much busier year for us this year than last, and a lot of innovation, because we are designed as a rotating shelter program. We have 14 churches around Greene County that serve as host sites, and our families move on a weekly basis. They stay in the evening and overnight at the churches and then return back to our day center here each morning, where they receive case management, assistance with jobs, housing, all those things, connecting them to resources in the community. Obviously, when the churches are not in full operation, our program does not move either. So our shelter program actually was shut down back in mid-March, along with a lot of other things. And we have a transitional apartment upstairs, a two-bedroom apartment here at our day center. So on June 1st, the family that was in there, we were able to help them find housing. And at that time, I approached the board, and we agreed that the right thing to do was to suspend our transitional apartment program and turn that into an emergency shelter. So we do have on-site emergency shelter services. Unfortunately, we are limited to two families because it's a two-bedroom apartment. So we have to limit that piece of it. what we ended up doing as a result of that is through the Zoom network here, we created a diversion program where we can also provide the same services to families while they're staying with relatives or friends or something. They're doubling up someplace and they can remain there. We can work with them and do weekly case management over the internet, and we can provide services of housing searches and all those things that they would get here without them having to make a move and come into the shelter program, which has been a great program. And I see that continuing even past the COVID pandemic. That's been a great tool for us. Obviously, we have faced a lot of the same struggles as most nonprofits during the year, and that was lack of fundraising opportunities, adjusting how fundraisers were held if we could do them. And so that was a piece where most of us were probably writing a lot of grants. And when we had COVID grants available on the local levels and on the state levels, everybody was getting all their paperwork rounded up and getting it in. But overall, as Teresa had mentioned, you know, it's just been such a phenomenal year. The generosity of individuals and the generosity of businesses throughout the county has been there. They've backed us up, and it's been what's kept us going, and we are ready to move. We are past December 37th, and we are in January of 2021, and we are moving forward. So we're really looking forward to getting back to some type of a normal rotation. And you know what? We're grateful for everything, but we're also hopeful that this year we're still going to get to be able to do that open house that we had planned in the spring of last year, because we bought our building in the fall of 2019 and moved into our new facility, and we have yet to be able to have an open house. So we're very hopeful for all of those things to happen. So I think there's a lot.
Real quickly, is there any way that our Green County leaders can get involved with Family Promise? Are there any big needs that you have that you need help from other leaders?
Well, here at the Day Center, typically we would have some volunteers coming in on a regular basis, helping with some of the data entry and things like that. Although we've been holding off because of the COVID, we're only working 3 days a week out of our Day Center and the other 2 days working from home until things get a little bit better. But we do have committees and they are meeting via the Zoom network. And so fundraising committees and personnel committees and things like that. So absolutely there are opportunities for people to get involved at different levels, as well as at our host sites once we get back into our rotation program again. So if you have questions about that, please give me a call or send me an email or something. I'd be happy to connect with you. So.
Great. Thank you very much, Rick. Yeah. We will, if there are questions that you have for Rick that weren't answered, feel free to put them in the chat. We'll make sure that Rick gets them and he can answer them by email or however it is easy for it to get a hold of you. So Marcia Voss then comes to us as the board chairperson for Green Cares Food Pantry. And I can imagine that food pantries are really meeting a very important need right now. Marcia, can you tell us a little about what you do and what the state of affairs is in food pantries?
Sure. We are the Green Cares Food Pantry. Sometimes there's confusion with the Monroe Pantry, which is called Green County Food Pantry. Both of us serve the same population. Actually, clients can go to ours as well as to the Monroe one and to the mobile pantry. So they have many places that they could go to it. We serve low-income families, basically, and we provide them with groceries, meat, produce, and bakery items. We figure it's about 7 to 10 days worth of groceries from us, and they come to the pantry once in a month's time. So we do ask them to make appointments and come in. It helps us you know, keep things smoothly moving along so that we don't have a big group of things. But we do get walk-ins, and they are more than welcome to come in at any time. Our pantry is located about 1/2 mile west of Monticello on County C. We began because they were hoping to help clients by providing a variety of days and hours for them to come. So we actually are open 12 times a month. So 3 times each week, Tuesday, Thursdays, and Saturdays at different times. So that gives them many chances to make it to the pantry when it's convenient for them. Our food sources are the Second Harvest Food Bank, government USDA surpluses, local grocery stores such as Miller's Grocery in Verona, New Glarus Bakery, Pick and Save, and Walmart in Monroe, as well as food drives, garden donations, and purchase products. So that's how we find what we need to give to our clients. We serve approximately 240 families a month, which is almost 800 individuals. Actually, that number is down a little from the start of the pandemic. And I will talk about that a little bit in a minute. When the pandemic started, we moved to a contactless delivery to our clients. So basically, when they come to the pantry, they call in and tell us that they have arrived. Usually they give us a little indication that they're in the blue truck and also that their family size is about 4. So that helps us get ready for them. So we get refrigerator and freezer items. We box up canned goods. We also bag up fresh produce and bakery items. And then our clients take them, or our volunteers take them to their car and load it up for them. We also would make an appointment at that time for the next month for them. The quantities that we give them depends on their family size. So we have guidelines all around the pantry that tell us how many cans of soup they would get if their family size is 3 to 4, or if it's 5 or more. So we try to give an appropriate amount for the family sizes that are coming. The disadvantage with people staying in their cars is that we don't get that one-on-one personal, you know, interaction with them. So we can't hear about, you know, maybe that they now found a part-time job, or, you know, that they are going to have a baby or something like that. So those personal touches are lost, but at the same time, it makes it safe and it allows us to continue to serve them. So that's one of the things that that we've felt was worthwhile. There have been some of our volunteers decided on their own that due to their family or their own health that they would stop volunteering. So that meant that in the middle months here in March, April, and May, and even actually this last month in December, that we had to search for new volunteers. And so that there's many different types of opportunities for people to volunteer. We thought, why would our numbers go down slightly? That's one of the things that we've talked about with our Second Harvest, with the USDA people. And we, first of all, in earlier in the year, they were all received a stimulus check. They got increased unemployment money. Some were feared COVID and didn't even want to drive to the pantry. Excuse me, 1 second here. And at the same time, the kids were getting meals from the schools. So all of these were things that made some of our pantry clients decide that they did not need to come to the pantry. And so, like I said, we did have a decrease in that. This decrease was not universal. If we talked to other people in Southern Wisconsin, and it was rural areas, such as our Greene County area, that had decreases in the usage of it. And I'm not talking a huge amount, you know, like 10 to 15%. But in the urban areas, there was that same increase. So
Marcia, you've just done a wonderful job telling us about how Green Cares is meeting important needs in Greene County. Are there any other ways besides volunteering that you think could be the most helpful for your organization? How could people get involved?
Basically, volunteering, the money donations and food drives are good things. This December, the end of November into December, we figure that we had probably 12,000 pounds of food drives. So those things came in. So people were, many of those were bigger organizations. Some people did small stuff and some always donate small things. We've had the 4-H and the Girl Scout groups have made up what we call birthday bags. So that's like a cake mix, some candles, if they're small children, a small toy, frosting. And so when we send out the appointment card, we have a small slip of paper, and it reminds them that if they have a birthday coming up, they just need to tell us so that we can get one of those bags that has been prepared for us. So that's been a great thing. Our sign outside has been kind of falling off the posts for years, and we had someone design a new sign for us and install it. And then the Monroe Clinic mission team paid for it. So that's some of the ways people come up with some very interesting things, and we usually try to do it. Recently we had several boxes of like hand sanitizers that we put into the bags that go outside. The extension has information on food, nutrition and recipes. And we stick those in the bags that go out all the time. So we try to get informational things out to them. So like I said, today we had about 12 volunteers that we just unloaded a USDA truck of about 8,000 pounds.
Wow, that's super. Thank you so much, Marcia. It's great to get the inside story from your organization.
Well, I appreciate the chance to talk with you.
Yeah, thank you. We have short time, so we need to move on. And we have with us Jeannie Bloomer she's the board chair of Southwest Community Action Program. Jeannie, tell us what's happening with Southwest CAP.
Hi, thank you for inviting me today. Southwest CAP is an anti-poverty organization that serves the Wisconsin counties of Grant, Green, Iowa, Lafayette, and Richland. We work to mitigate the causes of poverty and try to build resilience and self-sufficiency amongst our families. The Southwest CAP board is served from representatives from the five counties. I'm honored to serve with Victoria. And I see Chris Marion, although she's not a Greene County representative, but she's a member of the board. Mike Fergal, who is a Greene County board member, an advocate for veterans in our area, and Megan Reading, who newly came to the board, and myself. I wanted to talk about some projects you probably haven't heard about yet. Southwest CAP is the first company, or I should say organization, that's been approved to create farm worker housing. And we're gonna be having a 32 unit project in Darlington to serve farm workers. This has been a complaint from area farmers where they are struggling to find housing for their workers. And so you will hear much more about this. We're very excited about this because it's just not simply housing. We're going to bring services in to this area, including like ESL, Head Start, childcare. And you're right, childcare is a big issue right now. So we're gonna link these services to this site. So hopefully this will be a very positive results for our families that are farm workers in our area. Most recently in the last couple of years, you've probably heard about Southwest CAP as being a leader in mental health services and AODA treatment and follow-up care. We have been blessed through the Wisconsin Partnership Program at UW School of Medicine and Public Health by giving us funds to help create a mental health network that allows the counties to work together. When you look at Southwest CAP, you're going to see that oftentimes we are a collaborator. Sometimes we are the innovator, and sometimes we provide the services ourselves. In the case of the behavioral health, you're going to see a person that you all probably know, Bridget Mushan Humphreys, is the leader of this and coordinating mental health services through the five counties. After this presentation, you're going to get an email from me that's going to give you links to various things that you should maybe take a look at. I think it would provide you with more information. I'm also very pleased to see that we were able to set up halfway houses for those that are recovering from substance abuse. For someone to go into treatment and simply come back into the community and the living area that they were in is a setup for failure. So our homes provide a drug-free environment coupled with work, coupled with counseling, all those necessary wraparound services so that person can remain sober. And obviously that's a goal for all of us. Kim Hill is the coordinator at Southwest CAP for this. And again, one of the links is gonna show you some of her work. Most recently, due to COVID, Southwest CAP was awarded WRAP funds. That stands for Wisconsin Rental Assistance Program. Those monies were used to prevent evictions. And there was a sizable pot of money in the five counties, and that has been spent out. Actually, we were reallocated even more monies because Southwest CAP was actually one of the leaders in Wisconsin of getting applications in and turned around providing services to those people. So we didn't increase our numbers of people that Rick would see in Family Promise. We do know that there is more money coming or likely coming for housing assistance. We are hoping that this money will allow us to help people with mortgages. The last pot of money only helped with rental assistance. And of course, not everyone is a renter. There are some people with mortgages that are really, really struggling right now, especially with loss of income. I actually referred a family to Southwest CAP myself because they called me because they were having to pay for childcare now because their school is virtual and they had a five-year-old son. And not only did they have difficulties with childcare, but they were having difficulties with their mortgage because they were having to spend extra money to pay for childcare while they were working. So a lot of connections with childcare.
Jeannie, thank you so much for your comments. Is there quickly, just very quickly, since we need to move on, is there any way that in particular Greene County leaders, the leaders in this group could find ways to connect with you to be helpful?
Yes, there are. One thing that I didn't talk about is the LIFT program. This is the transportation program throughout the five counties. And the Lyft program is definitely looking for volunteer drivers to take people to medical appointments or get them to and from work. So while you may not be able to do it yourself, you may know of a retired person that's looking to do some quality work in the area, and that certainly would be an option.
And I assume you'll put that all that information in the email to us then, is that right? Or the information that Victoria will have?
The information I gave Victoria didn't include Lyft, but I can certainly send another one out.
That all does. Right. Yes, well, thank you so much for your comments. We really appreciate it. Our last speaker this afternoon is Deb Douglas. She's the executive director of Fowler Dental Clinic. And I know they do a lot of good work in helping young people with dental issues. Can you tell us more about that, Deb?
Absolutely. Thanks so much for the opportunity. And we have some great news to share, which is, but I'll get to that. Anyway, the Fowler Dental Clinic, for those of you who don't know about us, we provide dental care to those in need with a focus on the uninsured and those with limited access to oral health services. So we do this, we have the vision of creating a quality, comprehensive, and community-based dental home that reduces the barriers to care throughout the region and thereby improving the health of our neighbors and friends. We do this all with the underlying core values of inclusivity, clinical quality, community engagement, stewardship, and of course, integrity. So the history of the Fowler Dental Clinic, it opened on April 3rd in 2009 with volunteers and one dental chair, and began providing care for kids in Greene County between the ages of 3 and 12. Since then, we've just continued to grow through strong community and statewide partnerships. We were able to increase our eligible age. First, we increased it down to include kids from the day that their first tooth erupts all the way up to age 12. And then we've been slowly increasing that age up to 15 and 18. In 2014, we were able to create a new four-chair dental clinic in the old government services building out at the Pleasant View complex. And in that clinic, we were able then to work with a partnership of the Monroe Clinic Hospital to create a hospital-based dental program to provide dental care for kids under 7 years of age who have the most severe dental disease and caries. Those kids are just too young to be able to provide care in a traditional setting. So once we had the hospital-based care, of course, things seemed to be going pretty well. And then we found out that the building we were in was going to be demolished. So we did have to find a new home. And again, with strong partnerships in 2018, we were able to move to our new location. And we are currently on the Monroe Clinic Hospital Medical Campus, which is a perfect place for us to be, because we do continue to strengthen our relationship between medical and dental providers. So this is a great place for us to be. So on Friday, March 13th, COVID hit the dental industry and everywhere else. And so we had to suspend our services, but we took that opportunity to kind of create our fresh start. And in that time, again, working strong with our strong partnerships with the Monroe Clinic, especially, we were able to welcome a full-time dentist to our staff.
Wow. I think maybe we might have some frozen computer. Deb, have we lost you? Is anybody else able to hear Deb?
No. I am not. Deb, if you can hear us, I'm going to stop your video in case that helps.
The fun of working on Zoom.
Yeah. Hey, keeping it real, right? Keeping it real.
Keeping it real.
I think, so looking now, it looks like the connection has been, I think her internet connection has meant that she has had to drop off. We will wait a minute or two and see if she can join back on. We did have a question come in. And Kara, if I may, you may have a response for this. I know there's so much great stuff going on with childcare, and that is absolutely fantastic. If I understand correctly, you've also had conversations about housing in Greene County, and we had a question come in sort of talking about looking at housing availability in Greene County. Is there anything or any update that you could share?
Sure, I'm happy to share. So last year you may have heard about our Driftless Homes opportunities through Southwest CAP. Again, Jeannie Bloomer talked about different things that Southwest CAP provided. One of the great things that they provided was the opportunity for all counties in their area to work with a developer to potentially build housing, workforce housing in our counties. So we wouldn't have been able to do that without Southwest CAP. You may think that we have that maybe at my office here, I have developers knocking on my door saying, hey, I want to build housing in Greene County. Well, unfortunately, that's not the case. There are a few places in Greene County where we're seeing housing built, but we did a housing study last year, and we need housing for all throughout a person's lifetime. So from a person getting their first apartment to having a small family home to all the way to senior housing, and all through different income levels, we need housing in Greene County. So again, Southwest CAP afforded us that ability to work with the developer. And we went to all of our communities in Greene County to see if we could potentially work with communities to partner to get some housing built. We didn't get it done in 2020, but I'm very hopeful Southwest CAP has allowed us to continue to work with that Dimensions Development, which is Development Corporation. And I'm very hopeful that we will get something going, perhaps a different model to get some workforce housing built here in Greene County. So yes, that's at top of our radar. Yes, it's desperately needed. And yes, we're working on it, but getting housing built is a slow process.
Well, I just want to say, I think it was a great question. Thanks for the question coming in. And Kara, thanks for the update. I think that's a great example of how, just how holistic and how connected so many components of our community is. I think that's really the case. So I just wanna check in. Does anybody have any questions for the nonprofits on the panel? Feel free to put it in a chat.
Does someone know the good news from Fowler Dental Clinic? I saw it on Facebook, but is there anybody on the board or who can share the good news? I wanna know.
Can you tell us, Kara?
I'm willing to.
No, go for it.
I sit on the board. And Deb talked about all the changes. I've been there from the beginning of all of those changes. So the great news is that with the new placement and the facilities, some changes that were made during COVID, the clinic is now going to be able to see all patients, any age, in Greene and Lafayette counties that have Forward Health or no health insurance at all. So this has been something as a growing pain that we've had, and we decided it was time, after a lot of planning and directions and help from other people, we were, Deb and the crew down there were able to make it a go. So folks do need to call to schedule an appointment with them, or if they have any other questions, there's a website and a Facebook page, and maybe Deb could post that and her great poster that she's been throwing out in the community. So it's pretty exciting news for the unique population, or the unfortunate population, that doesn't have dental care. So that's Deb's great news. I didn't want to burst her bubble, but it's great news to share with everybody.
Thank you so much for sharing that. You know, I think it is amazing when you think about the things that brings together. The leadership in this community of people like Deb and yourself and all the board members for all the people, all the organizations, how they have this motivation to help the community. And then the people that are willing to put money and time and effort and so forth to make these things happen. So anyway, thank you very much, Sue. And please tell Deb that we appreciate her willingness to be here. Thank you so much to Rick and Marsha, Jeannie and Deb. And we're going to talk a little bit now. We're going to say goodbye by gathering together just quickly. Victoria will tell you about it. We're going to go into a small breakout group to say goodbye and to think about how grateful we are for this community. So Victoria?
Yeah. So, and I just want to quick say, again, thank you to all our speakers. We will reach out to Deb and ask her to do a quick video clip that we can post online. We totally recognize that there is, keeping it real, right? Internet connections are a thing. And I also see that there's a question that just came in about access to people who, dental access for people who speak Spanish. And the answer is yes. I know that Fowler has been working on that. So with that, I know there were so many great updates from so many great speakers. I don't know about you, but I feel like I learned a lot. I did not know, for example, that the pantry is doing birthday bags for kids. I think that's fantastic. I did not know about all these great examples of navigating real challenges. And we have a lot of challenges going on. At the same time, we have really strong networks and lots of great work being done in Greene County. I know we have a lot to be grateful for. So we are going to take a couple minutes of reflection. This is an opportunity also to quick connect with your fellow participants. We're going to go back to breakout sessions. And in those breakout sessions, please share one big takeaway or lesson you have from today's session. And if you have any good news you want to share, anything you want to celebrate, please share that. We're going to take about 5 minutes for that. And I'm going to pause the recording and you'll get an invite for a breakout session. I know there were so many great takeaways, so many great things going on in community. We are fortunate. Deb's tech worked out a little bit. She's going to give us a 2-minute update just because there's so much stuff that's going on. That's fantastic. And this is really beneficial to know. So I'm going to hand things over to Deb for a quick update and then we will wrap up. So Deb.
Okay. Thank you so much. And again, patience for all of the tech issues, but the big news from the Fowler Dental Clinic is that we are expanding our care. So we are currently able to see individuals from Greene and Lafayette County who are on Forward Health or Medicaid through the state of Wisconsin. All ages, from 1 year of age all the way up to 100. We are providing basic dental care, so people do have to understand that, but for basic dental care, if an individual has Forward Health through the state of Wisconsin, they can reach out to us and we will try to work them into our schedule. So we're super excited to be able to do that, and we look forward to expanding our care even more in the future to other populations. So stay tuned.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you, Deb. There's just a lot of great stuff going on, a lot of great work. So thank you everybody for joining us. We hope you can join us for the next session on Wednesday, February 10. We are going to be talking about resiliency and adaptability. If you haven't already done so, please be sure to sign up and invite your friends, family, neighbors, coworkers, everybody. It is open to anyone who lives or works in Greene County and it is free. So we will follow up this session with an email next week with additional resources and information. This will also be posted on our website. And later today, you will get an update. We really appreciate your perspectives on things. So we will ask you for some feedback on this. So with that, thank you for joining us for the January Greene County Leaders Session. It is a joy to be in community with you. Stay safe, everyone.